In the last lecture, we have discussed about moment generating function. Today, we shall discuss on some other function, which is a characteristic function. Because of in some cases, moment generating function does not exist. Since the integral of integral of series, which is definition of moment generating function, does not converge absolutely for a real value of t for some distribution. For example, in first case, where function is a continuous function, f of x equal to c by 1 upon c by 1 plus x square 1 raised to the power m, where m is a positive value and greater than 1, and x lies between minus infinity to infinity. In this case, moment generating function does not exist, since the integration over the limit minus infinity to plus infinity exponential of dx into c by 1 plus x square 1 raised to the power m with respect to x does not converge absolutely for finite positive value of m. In this case, exponential of tx denominator over x square, in this case, as x tends to infinity, approaches to infinity, and so integral of this function does not exist, or moment generating function does not exist in this case. In case of discrete distribution, if function of x is given by 6 by pi square x square, where x vary from 1 to 3 and so on, a positive integer value, and 0 elsewhere. Moment generating function also does not exist in this case, because in this case series does not converge absolutely by D Lambert ratio test. So in the both the cases where moment generating function does not exist, we generate a new function known as characteristic function. So a more serviceable function than moment generating function, what is known as characteristic function, and it is defined as phi x t, where phi represent characteristic function of random variable x and t be any real parameter. This is equal to exponential of expectation value of expectation of iota t x. In the discrete case, where x is a discrete random variable with probability mass function pi, characteristic function given by summation over the given range of exponential of iota tx into probability mass function. And in case of continuous distribution, integration of exponential of iota tx into function of x, which is probability density function in case of continuous distribution, integration with respect to x. Now, the characteristic function always exists, which means for every function, characteristic function tends to a finite value or converges to a absolutely finite value. In this case, first we find phi h t. Generally, phi h t is a complex valued function, so their complex value, which is equal to integration from minus infinity to infinity exponential of iota tx function of x tx, always less than or equal to minus infinity to infinity exponential of iota tx mod value and function of x tx. Now, mod of iota tx, exponential of iota tx, which is equal to mod of cos iota tx, cos tx plus iota sin tx whole raised to the power half, and the mod value of cos tx plus iota sin tx is equal to 1, cos square t plus sin square t, which is equal to always 1 identity whole raised to the power half equal to half. And this implies that, so in this case, less than or equal to by the property of modulus value. And so here minus infinity to infinity mod value of iota tx exponential of iota tx is equal to 1 function of x dx, and integral over of the probability density function over the complete range minus infinity to infinity is equal to 1. And so mode of characteristic function is always less than or equal to 1, and therefore characteristic function always exists. Characteristic function. First property, the arc moment about the origin is denoted by mu r dash equal to expected value of x raised to the power r is equal to coefficient of iota t1 raised to the power r divided by factorial r in the expansion of characteristic function in the series of ascending power of i t. We can prove easily this one by the general expansion of exponential function. Expected value of iota tx, exponential of iota tx equal to expected value of exponential of iota tx equal to 1 plus iota tx plus iota tx whole square by factorial 2 and so on. So in this case, expectation of 1 is equal to 1, expectation of iota tx, iota t is a constant so outside the expected value, and finally expectation of x plus in the second term, in the third term, iota t whole square by factorial 2 outside the expected value, and we get expectation of x square, which is second moment about the origin, or mu 2 dash. Similarly for arc moment about the origin, we get mu r dash with the coefficient of iota t whole raised to the power r upon factorial r. We can write in summation form, or abbreviately as summation over r equal to 0 to infinity mu r dash iota t whole raised to the power r divided by factorial r. So arc moment about the origin is equal to coefficient of iota t whole raised to the power r divided by factorial r in the expansion of characteristic function. Now the second property, mu r dash arc moment about the origin is equal to 1 upon iota whole raised to the power r differentiation with respect to r times with respect to t of characteristic function, and then we put t equal to 0, because phi of h t equal to 1 plus iota t expectation of x plus iota t whole square by factorial 2 expectation of x square plus and so on. If we differentiate with respect to t, we get differentiation of 1 first term 0 plus differentiation of iota t expectation of x is equal to, or expectation of x equal to mu 1 dash in this case, and differentiation of t equal to 1, so mu 1 dash plus iota t 2 iota t into iota factorial 2 expectation of x square means mu 2 dash plus and so on, and then we put t equal to 0 in this case, we get at t equal to 0 in first term mu 1 dash, in second term becomes 0, and all other terms where t raised to the power 2 or more than 2, the whole terms becomes 0, and therefore mu 1 dash equal to, or first moment about the origin is given by differentiation of characteristic function with respect to t, and then put t equal to 0. And similarly by mathematical induction, we get arc moment about the origin by the formula 1 upon iota whole raised to the power r, in this case also 1 upon iota, r time differentiation of characteristic function with respect to t, and then put t equal to 0. So we can find moment generating or moments about the origin with help of characteristic function by this formula. The third property, if characteristic function of a random variable x, discrete or continuous, is phi x t, then y equal to x plus a linear function in x, then characteristic function of y is equal to exponential of iota v t phi of x at a t, where here parameter change into a t and multiply with iota v t. We can easily prove this one, because expectation of y for moment and characteristic function of y equal to exponent, in case of discrete distribution, iota t bar to pi, probability mass function. So summation in this case, or expectation of exponential of iota t bar. Here y equal to ax plus b, in this case exponential of iota atx plus iota tb. Here base same, so we can split into iota atx plus into exponential of iota tb, which is a constant value, so outside the integral sign, expected value iota tb exponential of iota atx, which is characteristic function of x with the parameter at and multiply with iota t. And if x and y independent random variable, then sum of these two random variable x plus y, then characteristic function of sum of these two random variable equal to multiplication of their individual characteristic function. Now in the next section we shall discuss on bounds on the probabilities, and this condition we find in that case where expectation of x and variance are known but distribution not known. Because if we know probability distribution of a random variable x, probability density function in case of continuous distribution, and probability mass function in case of discrete case, we may compute expectation of x and variance of x easily. For example, in case of, if we know binomial distribution, then we can find the mean of the binomial distribution or expectation of x equal to np, number of trial, into probability of success, and we also can find the variance of x, which is equal to npq. If we know probability distribution of random variable, for example, in case of Poisson distribution, we know probability distribution of Poisson distribution, so in that case we can find mean and variance, which is equal to lambda, parameter of Poisson distribution. But conversely, if expectation of x and variance of x are known, then we cannot construct a probability distribution of x, and hence compute the quantities such as probability of mode of x minus expectation of x, or mode of expectation of mode of x minus mu, or less than equal to k. Although we cannot evaluate such probability from the knowledge of expectation of x or variance of x, but several approximation techniques have been developed yield to upper or lower bounds to of such probability. The most important of such techniques is Chebyshev's inequality. So in this case, if we cannot evaluate probability of mode of x minus expectation of x less than equal to k exactly, but we can find a lower bound or a upper bound in this case by the techniques of Chebyshev's inequality. And Chebyshev inequality generally used when distribution not known and mean and variance of the distribution are known. Statement: if a random variable x with expectation of x equal to mu and variance of x equal to sigma square, then probability of mode of x minus mu, which is greater than or equal to c, is always less than or equal to sigma square by c, where sigma square variance and c be any value where which is greater than or equal, greater than 0 only, not equal to 0, because in that in case if c equal to 0, it become infinity or undefined values. So c is always greater than 0. Now proof of Chebyshev's inequality: if x is a random variable then variance of x equal to integral over the limit minus infinity to infinity x minus mu whole square multiply with the probability density function and integrate with respect to x. Now we split the integral in the sub intervals where minus infinity to mu minus x or x minus mu plus x minus mu to x plus mu and plus x plus mu to infinity and remaining function as it is in the all these cases we are integrating with respect to x. We convert the interval into three sub intervals and if we eliminate any interval or any sub interval then this value is less than or equal to variance of x and in this case variance of x is greater than equal to that value. So if we eliminate the integral over the x minus mu to x plus mu x minus mu whole square function of x dx then sigma square is greater than or equal to minus infinity to mu minus c x minus mu whole square function of x dx plus mu plus c to infinity x minus mu whole square function of x integration with respect to x. Now in the first interval x is less than mu minus c and therefore x minus mu is greater than c or x minus mu is less than minus c. If we transpose this one mu then x minus mu less than minus c and if we square this one x minus mu whole square is always greater than or equal to c square and in second integral x is greater than mu plus c so x minus mu greater than c and their square also is greater than or equal to c square. Now we put this in values in the given functions. So sigma square is greater than equal to we put x minus mu whole square is equal to greater than c square. So in this case c square common in the both the integral and now limit minus infinity to mu minus c function of x dx and mu plus c to infinity function of x dx which is equal to 1 minus probability of x minus because of if mu minus c mu plus c and x lies between this one then remaining values should minus infinity to mu minus c and plus infinity mu plus c to plus infinity. So total probability of in this interval is equal to 1. So probability of minus infinity to mu minus c function of x dx to plus mu plus c to plus infinity function of x dx is equal to 1 minus probability of x lies between mu minus c to mu plus c. We subtract this one from 1. So, probability of this and finally we get c square probability of x minus mu greater than or equal to c which is equation second. Now with second and first what we will get sigma square greater than or equal to c square probability of x minus mu greater than or equal to c and place the probability of x minus mu greater than or equal to c is less than equal to sigma square by c square which is the result of Chebyshev's inequality or we can write probability of x minus mu less than equal to c is greater than or equal to 1 minus sigma square by c square because of total probability always remains same in this case. Now, the alternative term, if you put c equal to k sigma, where k is greater than 0, then summation infinity takes the form probability of x minus mu by k in mode value always greater than equal to sigma. Then their probability is always less than equal to 1 by k square. And if probability of mode value of x minus mu by k less than sigma, then always greater than or equal to 1 minus 1 by k square. So in this case, if probability, expectation or variance are known, then we can find probability lower bound or upper bound of the probability. The workout example, if a random variable x with mean mu equal to 12 and variance equal to 9 and unknown probability distribution, and have a known probability distribution, find the probability of, so now we want to find probability of a random variable x where x is greater than 6 and less than n. In this case, probability distribution of random variable x not known, so in this case we cannot find the exact value of this probability, and we can find the lower bound of the probability by Chebyshev's inequality. By Chebyshev's inequality, probability of x minus mu by sigma or x minus mu by k is always less than or equal to sigma, is always greater than or equal to 1 minus 1 by k square. Or in this case, probability of x is greater than 6 and less than equal to 8. Or we can use the remaining formula for less than equal to c, sigma square by c square. So here x minus mu, or we can write x is greater than or equal to or less than or equal to, or x minus mu less than equal to, x is less than equal to c and greater than equal to minus c, is greater than or equal to 1 minus sigma square by c square. Now probability of mu minus c equal to 6, we get probability of x greater than 6 and less than equal to 18 is always greater than or equal to 1 minus here sigma square equal to 9 and c square means 6 square 36, so which is greater than or equal to 27 by 36 and which is equal to 3 by 4. So lower bound of the probability is 3 by 4 in this case. If probability distribution function is not known, then probability of random variable x which is greater than equal to 6 and less than equal to s is always greater than or equal to 3 by 4, not less than equal to 3 by 4. In the second example, can we find a random variable x for which this given probability equal to 0.6. So in this case, if mu minus 2 sigma is less than equal to x and is less than equal to mu plus 2 sigma, by Chebyshev's inequality, probability of x minus mu is greater than minus 2 sigma and less than equal to 2 sigma, equal to probability of x minus mu mode value is less than or equal to 2 sigma by Chebyshev infinity, which is equal to greater than or equal to 1 minus sigma square by c square. Here c is equal to 2 sigma, so 4 sigma square. Sigma square cancelled by sigma square, and then 1 minus 1 by 4, which is greater than or equal to 3 by 4 or equal to 3 by 4. So probability of given value is always, or probability of this value have a lower bound, which is 3 by 4. So probability always greater than or equal to 3 by 4, and here given 0.6 doesn't. So there does not exist a random variable for that the probability for this interval exists. The second one is the Markov inequality on the bounds of probability. A function of x equal to 0 for x is less than equal to less than 0, and then for any value alpha which is greater than 0, probability of x minus probability of x is greater than or equal to alpha is always less than equal to expected value of x divided by alpha. So we start the proof with the given value expectation of x. Expectation of x in case of continuous distribution 0 to infinity, because of for x is less than 0, function equal to 0. X into function of x dx. But here alpha is greater than 0, and probability of x greater than equal to alpha. So x is greater than equal to alpha. Expected value of x when x is greater than alpha, if you put in place of 0, or 0 convert the interval into two sub intervals 0 to alpha and alpha to infinity. 0 to alpha x into function of x dx plus alpha to infinity x into function of x dx. But in case of alpha, here if we remove this value, then expectation of x is greater than or equal to alpha to infinity, here x equal to alpha, function of x dx, because x is greater than or equal to alpha, and therefore which is equal to alpha to infinity function of x dx. This part shows probability of x greater than or equal to alpha, and so probability of x greater than or equal to alpha is always less than equal to expectation of x divided by alpha. And which is known as Markov inequality. Now the next bounds on the probability, which is Chernoff bounds. Chernoff bounds find where moment generating function are known, or with help of moment generating function. If x be a random variable with moment generating function mxt equal to expected value of tx, then for a is greater than or equal to 0, probability of x greater than or equal to a is always less than or equal to exponential of minus at into moment generating function of x for all t is greater than 0, and in second case when all t is less than 0. We can easily prove this theorem because of probability of x greater than or by the Markov inequality, greater than or equal to a is equal to probability of exponential of x or exponential of. So here if t is greater than 0, then xt is also greater than or equal to at, and therefore probability of exponential of xt is greater than or equal to exponential of at. Now we apply Markov inequality in this case and treating exponential of xt as a random variable. So in this case, exponential of xt is always greater than or equal to exponential of at, and which is less than or equal to expectation of exponential of xt divided by a exponential of at, or less than or equal to exponential of minus at into expectation of exponential of x t. This is the first result. Similarly, we can find the second result. Since the Carnot bound holds for all value of t, either positive or negative by time, we obtain the best bound on probability of x greater than equal to a by using that t that minimizes the exponential of minus a t, mx t.